So you see this as information?
Yeah, this would be...
And I think that's the right way to do it. I mean, otherwise, the policy science team could become the political science team.
Right.
If you were making decisions, which would be a bad thing. But if it's just a fund, font, if you will, of knowledge, where people with vexing questions can go, and I guess the head of the science part would decide whether or not it would be a waste of time to address it or whether you had enough information on it to inform the people who, in a non-operational, non-political way, who would be used that information to make decisions.
Right. That's
in another group.
Right.
That sounds good.
Peter, I think an important aspect of this is identifying the problem up front. And my concern has been that science is off developing projects and looking at things, and oftentimes takes many, many years to gather enough information to be satisfied that they're ready to render an opinion. Policymakers respect that. Policymakers, on the other hand, are anxious to do something and are generally spring-loaded to act. And I think there's some respect from the science community towards policymakers about that. But the two operate in a realm of some mistrust. And I think I see the value of this is coming together, policymakers and appropriate science team members, to identify the problem right up front and to address the political, the financial realities from the policy side, and to identify the scientific realities from the science side. And in doing so, you should be able to map out an approach that leads to an effective monitoring program, research program, unto implementation. So I think it starts at the point of identifying what is the issue, what is the problem we're going to try and fix, and then that leads to a cooperative effort that will probably speed things up and yield a better result.
Okay. Thank you. And actually, we agree with that. That was actually a bullet I hadn't got to. So that's, if you like, setting the grand challenges, the big questions. How do you structure the science then to address those questions? And you'll see in the following slides that flow of information down and back up again to this group. But that's really important, Randy. Thank you for raising that.
Yeah, I mean, it would be great to have scientists like one-armed lawyers, where, you know, you find lawyers say, well, on one hand is this, and one hand is the other. The scientists tend to do the same thing. And I think a lot of these decisions have to be made more on judgment than on fact. I mean, you have to make a decision. You have to say, what is the current state of the knowledge? You know, and what's the probability that it's going to be A or probability B, and then judge accordingly. And so many scientists are reluctant to say, this is, you know, the probability this is going to happen or that. And so we are relying on policy members who are not as well informed as they should be, because they're then assessing those probabilities and assigning them. And the scientific community, now in a corporate world, it's a little bit different, you know, because you can say, if you don't give me, you know, your best probability estimate, then you can look for another job. And people will respond under those conditions, and decisions, better decisions, will be made as a result. Mm-hmm.
Do the slides to come explain which questions are presented to the policy science team, who presents them, do they precede decisions, operational decisions, I mean, any of that?
Actually, what, maybe we can just go to the next slide to take a...
Could we agree that next time we use slides, we have copies we can look at?
Oh, okay. That's, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Agreed to that a long time ago.
Yeah. I mean, I've not seen these slides. Nobody's seen the slides. We'd like to see the slides.
Okay. Actually, how are we doing for time? It's almost noon, because if you want to work from slides, we can easily run off copies.
No. How long do you need to complete your testimony?
Actually, depends on question. 10 minutes would probably just give an overview of the key elements.
Okay, 10 minutes.
Okay.
Okay.
So this just shows the connection. We looked at the policy science team at the top there. We have the science community on the left. We'll break that down in a moment. But also, and this gets to Chair Eisenberg's comment about the management, what actually changes things on the ground, the management decisions, the operations. So we'll talk about that a little bit. But then, in addition to that, there's, if this is the triangle on how decisions are being made, there's the policy management interface. And this is something which we don't intend to cover in the science plan, because really, when you look at how things happen, this is, if you like, the sovereign territory of the individual agencies. It's how they structure themselves internally to manage programs and projects. So we have the science policy, which is the high level, the setting of the priorities, but at the same time, there's the science management teams and how do these interface. So if you define the management as select and implement management-based policy directives, on one side, currently we have the science community that develop and synthesize the best available science, but then we have the need to understand and how does that best available science that's developed through the science community feed up to the management directly. And so here we feel that many of those science management teams, and there's many, many of them out there in the Delta, they're already in place. And so we've been concentrating on how perhaps a broader base of science and knowledge can feed into those science teams. And this is just one of many, many examples that we could have pulled out. So you have the water operations and management team. On one side, they're responsible for the your day-to-day operations. So what are the questions that they really need to know? And what technologies are coming down the road that could make their jobs a lot easier? What's the uncertainty associated with the science? And how do you actually focus the science in the long term to help and improve this decision-making process? And so within this structure, those are the questions which we want to get to.
Is there any funding involved with this?
For these
meetings, these seminars, how are you going to call them? Do you pay people to come from the scientific side?
I think a lot depends on the program itself. Right now, for agency scientists, if it's important, if it's helping their mission, absolutely they can be there. One of the things we've been wondering is sort of looking at the model for the private sector and for other groups. But that's really how we finance and support this program. That's another topic, and we really haven't thought through that. A lot of few suggestions have been thrown out. But it is a real issue how you get the right people to the table if it's not part of their position description in their agency.
Yeah, I don't know if you have a definitive proposal today. It seems like a work in process. But I think the idea, personally, is a very good one, that we have a group of scientists who are basically dedicated to the Delta, to whom issues can be addressed. And seminars can be planned a year or two in advance, maybe on a monthly or a quarterly basis, on topical issues of interest. And I think the only stipulation from my standpoint, if all that happens, is that you have a phone-in capability so that it can be an audio conference. A lot of us are not here, and I presume they'll all be held in this area so that you could phone in and ask questions. And it'd be more or less informal.
That's a good, very good point, particularly with the technologies and even your webcasts and WebEx and things
audio,
like this.
Yeah.
Okay, and then this just puts the organizing science into the big picture, and then we'll talk through just a couple of examples of what's different. In the left-hand side on the screen there, if you like, you could view that as the infrastructure. It's the research, the monitoring, the shared models, how you communicate, how you create a repository of knowledge to support the science. On the top there, we put the Delta Independent Science Board. They're a very important review board. They're not the only ones, but we've actually put a lot of thought about how can you feed information from science to these review boards in a way that's efficient not only for the board but for the agencies that invest a lot of money in staff and preparation for the, for these types of reviews. The Delta Science Program there is shown purely as a facilitator to make these things happen. So we have the policy and the management on the right side, and then we have the science, which is in the blue. So what we've been focusing on, I think on the left-hand side there, there's not too much, or there's not likely to be too much disagreement in the general principles of research infrastructure, and it's probably something that we as a science community have a good handle on, the needs and what we need to put together. What we've been focusing on is how you build the science in such a way that you can then feed the policy through the policy science team, and how you can feed the science, a much broader science, into those science management teams. And so to do that, within that black box, of course, there's many very, very major programs. We had about BDCP, State Water Resource Control Board, already today. So what we're looking at is how the science through all of those programs may possibly fit together. And the key point here is the suggestion to consider a Delta Science Synthesis team.
What does that mean?
And what this role is to conduct the system-wide big picture synthesis and analysis of what's going on, how the system is actually responding. So some of their functions are many. One of those things is that the concept of developing beneath the science plan a work plan or a roadmap for, say, a two-year period. It would also hone the research questions. So from that policy science team, where these big questions have been laid out, how do you then convert those big questions and get it down to a level where you could put it out to a competitive research program? There needs to be some translation building on what's already available. So that would be one of the functions of the synthesis team. In addition, the State of the Delta Science report that Dr. Healy led a few years ago was very well received, and people thought that was a very valuable function. So this Delta Science Synthesis team would also be responsible in the same way that Dr. Healy did, was to reach out across the science leadership and put this State of the Delta Science together. We'd like to take that a step further with this group, and for the funded research and science which is being done on the Delta, to take a look at the annual and final reports from that science and actually look at what is new, what has been developed in the last 2 years, and specifically then to feed it back to the big questions that are coming from the policy science team, so that we can have a hard look. Here are the questions which we're struggling with. What in this period has actually resulted in action that now we know a lot more information, we're making better decisions? If we can't demonstrate that, then you come back and you revisit the questions and you redo the work plan. We also feel that putting out this State of the Delta Science in this form would really aid the reviews. So the role that ISB have had, and I think they're doing a great job in the review of science in support of adaptive management. But it's really been a struggle. It's such a broad topic that for them to come in and conduct a review right across all of the agencies and how they did that, there's been a lot of discussion with agencies. I think it's been good, but it's really taken a lot of time. But if they were to have this document to start their review, it would help them target on what the issues are. It would be a lot more focused, and then they can pick and choose where they think either great things are going on or where our knowledge is lacking. And we think this is important because unquestionably we're now in this new era of accountability. And these questions are just going to be asked more frequently at the federal and the state level. And so this would be a very definite circle of reviews. To go to the second level of this science synthesis, you can see there there's focused science synthesis teams. These are current programs which are already in place. And these initial or these programs will then feed upwards into the Delta Science Synthesis team to get a much more holistic view. And what we particularly like in these focused science synthesis teams is where there is a program in place, for example, I'll pick on IEP, helping the outcomes of IEP, and they're doing some very good thinking on how this is actually structured now. But adopting something like the NCES model, the National Center for Ecological Analysis and Synthesis, would be one. An NRC review where you pull in an outside people to produce some sort of publication. The science panels which we convene are all mechanisms to develop these specific outcomes. And so as a typical example there, here we have the science synthesis team. You at the top that's trying to develop this holistic understanding of how everything fits together. You, as an example, which has already been completed, so under IEP, their focused science synthesis team was at the POD, the 10-year effort, pelagic organism decline. As part of that, to get the science, they put together an NCES proposal actually through the NCES Center that focused on a specific aspect of that synthesis effort. Beneath that, there were work teams which were open that focused on different elements of this synthesis. There was a food webs team, for example, contaminants team, and there were several others. So those work teams feed up to the synthesis that is then conducted through an NCES type process that we would hope to have in place. And so that's been happening in some places where what we don't have right now is what the National Research Council pointed out, that then how does this effort in one specific area feed up to this much bigger understanding, and I think that reflects many of the council's sentiments in the last two discussions. How do these things fit together? So that is just a very fast.
And the answer is? The tentative answer is, how do they fit together? How does it get up the chain? How is it usable by anyone for anything?
Okay, so here in that particular example, we would have seen the research that came out of the food web, contaminant, and other work teams that were associated with IEP.
Right.
That would then feed into one of the questions which had been posed at the Focus Science Synthesis team with the idea of a publication, other products that specifically address that question.
Or is it your intent or your proposal that the products of these synthesis teams will be the declaration of the best available science? And if so, for how long a period of time? And may a project applicant rely on these conclusions in developing their project?
I think that outcomes typically in these processes, you see two things. One may be a white paper, which is updated from time to time. That's a statement of the current understanding. Really, the gold standard is peer review articles. So the way NCES works is that they want to see publications in the most appropriate and best journals. So I think that those would be the summation of the two outcomes of the statement of the science.
I guess I'm not being clear. Let's say I'm a project applicant for what will be a covered action under state law, big project, complicated, incurring within the statutory delta or the Suisun Marsh. Am I required by the science plan to do anything in preparing my covered action plan?
I think with the that's a good point. We had some discussion on that as to what would be required if it's coming in under adaptive management. Yes, there would be guidelines within the science plan to address those.
Like what?
We haven't monitoring requirements, for example.
Well, here's the thing, Peter. This is the third or fourth iteration of concepts. It's getting slightly more detailed. But everybody in the policy world wants to know, what do I have to do? Who do I have to talk to? When do I have to talk to them? And what kinds of things am I required to do as part of this whole process, if anything? And this sounds like an internal science discussion, which is terrific. I like the idea. But I do not understand how you intend to have it used, if you intend to have it used. For example, if the council faces a covered action hearing, as we will, you know, periodically, may we turn to the Delta Science Program and say, is this consistent with the Delta Plan? And you would say?
From the science perspective?
Well, I assume if it's a science plan, it's from the science perspective. Yes.
Could I interrupt, Peter, just for a second?
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds like a terrific idea. I mean, you're going to do white papers, and those white papers will represent the current status of the science.
Right.
And if someone is going to come in and go with a covered action, and those white papers are out there, one would assume that they would be employed by
the
other.
That's my assumption.
But not mandatory. But a logical person would say, gee, if this is, you know, the latest decision on the status of the science, then I'm going to employ that.
Yeah, I mean,
it would be great. It would facilitate things, maybe make things faster.
I think that's one part of it is, do you have the best available science? The other part is, are you consistent with the requirement to have an adaptive management plan on a covered action? And one of the things we have been talking about, which we haven't gotten that far along yet, it hasn't been vetted through the other agencies, is whether we should create a voluntary certification, for example, of the covered actions, that you are consistent with an adaptive management program. And I think that gets at what you're pushing towards.
I think science, independent science, and scientific judgment becomes of value to project applicants, state and local agencies, when they can, with some level of confidence, rely upon the scientific expression. Now, can't stop anybody from filing a lawsuit all you want, but with some credible reliance upon this, say, you know, I've done the best, I've used the best available science, I've consulted with these experts 476 times, I've had independent review panels of the following elements of my plan, all of which is reflected in the Delta Science Plan, then the science plan is informative to the first audience, and also to the project applicants, and to the citizenry of California who may be skeptical about the project. But it's that linkage is missing in this, to me. I don't see any signs of it yet.
Why do you say that's missing?
Well, because a project applicant wants to know, do I have to have, everyone will say, we're doing adaptive management. That's because nobody's defined it very clearly. Will covered actions, let's just take the area where the council has some authority, will covered actions be judged against these measures? And the answer probably is yes. But a science plan should arguably say that if it's the Delta Stewardship Council / Delta Science Program plan, because a project applicant would say, oh, okay, I understand. It's a food web decision. They've made the following declarations on, let's say, ammonium impacts on the food web. Build it into the planning and reflect. It's taking the conceptual stuff and translating it into operational provisions that interest me. And by the way, I'd go farther than just hoping for something. I'm in favor of good faith activities and giving some kind of, you can't give absolute certainty, but give at least some assurances to people that if they comply with whatever it is being done, they have met the threshold that the science people say is the current best available knowledge we have.
I guess what I'm seeing you talk about, Phil, is being prescriptive. And in order to get the nod that you are appropriate or inappropriate, you've got to do 1, 2, 3, and 4. I see this as being the body of science that's out there, together with articles and peer-reviewed journals, white papers, and all the rest of that. That if it's out there, then you should employ that to support what you want to do. But you shouldn't be required to get peer-reviewed articles and white papers and all the rest of that.
Well, then, okay,
that's the adaptive management part.
Okay, then how should the council judge this on a covered action?
On the evidence that's available.
And actually, I was just struggling to think
of
a good...
Can't do more than that, Phil.
Well, you... If a project... Look, the BDCP project essentially has set up a complicated array of checks and scientific involvement and so on. And they are attempting to, successfully or not, they're attempting to conform their proposals as best as they can to the scientific opinions they've been receiving. And our hope is that if there is a Delta Science Plan extant, that becomes kind of the overview measure.
Until it changes.
Until it changes. Oh, of course. Of course. That's right. Yeah. But projects and proposals come up at definite times requiring decisions, at least from the policymakers. And so it's that intersection that I want. My experience has always been applicants want to know, what do we have to do? When do we have to do it? What information do we have to provide? And on the science side, because it's becoming increasingly important in the Delta and water kinds of policies, the scientific information, the consultation, the clarity of it, arguably ought to give some level of assurance to project applicants. These guys are tough, but we've reviewed the stuff. We've incorporated the following elements. I mean, if it's appropriate. If it's not appropriate... And for something that doesn't come before us as a covered action, you know, the issue maybe doesn't rise at all. But for at least the covered actions, I'm kind of curious about what we'd want to see from a science plan. Because I don't want to...
In writing.
And actually, can I just give... I was trying to think of a good example, Phil. There's a proposed large wetland project you're designed by consultants that's just gone through. We think it's a really good model of how to do things.
Right.
So the consultants went through, there was very specific objectives of what they're trying to achieve with the restoration. They took the DREREP conceptual models, which are probably the best we have out there right now. They've been published. They pulled together a large group of experts who walked through the conceptual models and looked at different alternatives for the design. So there they were, had made an effort to reach out to the best available science that was in the literature, the experts in the area, and the outcome of that design will be much, much better for the process. So those sorts of things, recommendations of how you link to the best available science, and it may be that there's other things out there, but if it's justified... that there's a better model out there now that we're going to use this and we're using it for these reasons, then people should have that option. But what you're saying, I think, is actually exactly what you'll find included in here. It's under the science management interface. But perhaps just to give us some advice on this, just this overall structure of this science synthesis team. The other thing I should say about that, a subset of that science synthesis team would be the representatives on that policy science team. We feel the policy science team needs to be small enough to be effective. And so the membership of that would be a subset of this Delta science synthesis team, that they're active, they know what's going on. And that's how information flows back up from the science towards the policy level. But does that kind of interface resonate with what your thinking is?
I like the idea. You know, I think you ought to do it. You know, get a little more specificity on it, a little more detail. And then basically it's going to be adaptive management too. Certain things are going to work, certain things are not, but be amenable to change. And I like the idea of having a group that we can go to, not for immediate answers, because I know it's pretty difficult to get immediate answers from scientists unless you have basically 85% of all the necessary factual information, but put in programs to get information. You know, it's going to take some time, but go at it in a disciplined, rational fashion. And have a store of knowledge in the form of white papers and peer review articles on certain things, so that when we need information to support or to prevent something from going through, there's a faster way of getting it.
Okay. All right. Well, this is not an action item for us. So you're going to have to... When's the deadline? When do you expect to have a first draft?
We were
refresh my memory. I just don't recall.
We were hoping to have a first draft in early April, or at least something where we can... A draft where we can get response from the science community, because there's about three or four meetings in April where we would have an opportunity to discuss this.
If you're able to do that, I think it would be good. I think realistically, from what we heard in the last agenda item, we're going to be locked up with other things April and May and all of May. And so if you get your first draft out for science community comments, and I assume it's a public document, in April, that would be helpful, and we'd, you know, later in the year, sure, we'd circle back to the discussion. Yeah.
And then you may want to run it by the putative participants from the policy side, make sure that the individuals will be interested in this, and maybe get their feedback.
Oh, absolutely, no. Good
idea.
You
already done that?
With some of the principles, yeah, but okay. As we get more specifics, of course, it needs to work across so many levels.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, it is 23 minutes after 12. We will start at 12.